I'm City Councilor Mary Ann LaBarge, Chair on the Committee on Social Services, Veterans, Culture, and Recreation. I'd like to introduce the committee members. To my right is the City Councilor from Ward 4, Gina Louise Shiera. And to my left is the City Councilor from Ward 7, Alyssa Klein. I also want to announce that this meeting is also videoed and recorded by NCTV. Okay, all members are here. I would like to make a motion of approval of the minutes of May 18th, 2015 and June 15th, 2015.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Any public comment? I don't see any. I would like to welcome Deborah Anthony, who is the Executive Director of the Academy of Music. So Debbie, will you get a chair for her and bring her up?
Sure.
Now Deborah, we're gonna bring you up here closer, all three of you.
Oh, okay.
You can come right up here.
Sure.
Do you want us just to sit over here at the desk?
If you want to do that, come up closer.
Sure, sure.
All of us can do that.
I'm not first, I'll just stand.
Okay. We don't have any microphones, so you really have to speak loud.
Okay. You can't hear me, raise your hand.
So Tom, you're going first?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm Tom Douglas, I'm the architect for the renovations of the Academy of Music. Tiny bit of background, I did the renovation of the Calvin Theater back a long time ago, and I've worked on some other theaters. One is the Mohawk Theater in North Adams, and worked on the Amherst Cinema before they tore it down and remade it into a different thing. And I've done a lot of hospitality work, but to go way back, when I first started working with the Academy was in about 2008, and they had just gotten a grant, $2 million grant, to rehab the brickwork on the exterior of the building. And at that time, they tore off the marquee in the front. I'm sure you've all heard this story, but they tore off the old marquee. And this is a picture of the marquee as it existed in 1960. And I think this goes back to the 30s, that Art Deco marquee. So you see the 60s car and the porte cochere. So I volunteered at that time to help them think about how they could rebuild the marquee, because it looked like they were never going to be able to do that again. It was kind of very shocking when it was gone. So I worked with the CPA and the Academy to help them get money and to design it. This was a slide that we showed to the CPA when we presented to them, and it just shows where we were thinking of putting the new marquee and then where we were going to be poking holes in the building. And then this preceded me. These were some images that were done prior to my design work. And these were just kind of a remake of the old marquee in a slightly more modern style. And then they were looking at, well, where can we put those neon letters? So I looked at this, but I took a different tack. I decided I wanted to look back in history and see something that was a little bit more substantial. And I looked at tons of theaters. And this is a good example of a projecting canopy. Doesn't have any signage, but it gives you this great protection over the front of a building, and this building is very similar to the Academy. This is the same building lit up at night after it was renovated. This is Carnegie Hall, which was built about the same time as the Academy, which has a similar marquee, and that's the detail of the marquee. And we've looked at lots of details like this, trying to figure out what's appropriate, because it's never been on the theater before. It was always this Art Deco marquee that projected about 12 inches off the building. So this is one of our early renderings we did, where we did a projecting canopy. And it was a big deal because it was all made of steel, and it had to go through the steel, had to go through back through the lobby and tie into the main structure. But this is what in the end, they decided to do. And you can see that's the old yard sign that they used to have there. And then we were looking at different ways of lighting the facade to make it more of a destination, more important looking place at night. We of course got approval from Mass Historic for every single thing we did, because there's a deed restriction on the building for anything you do on the inside or the outside. So every project we've done there, we've gotten approval from Mass Historic. We did a full set of drawings. This was one of them. We did very elaborate detailing for the mark, the sign that's there now. This is like a detail of the front of the marquee and how it projects about 10 feet off the building. And then we built it. So that was our first round of work that I did with the Academy and where we got funding from the CPA. So the CPA put in a lot of money for this, thankfully. And then they got a grant from Mass Cultural Arts, Cultural Facilities Fund to pay for part of this. But this was a vast improvement to the Academy and all of a sudden gave them instant credibility and ability to market themselves. So we did a number of other exterior projects, replaced a bunch of exterior doors and windows. And then the final, well, it'll probably never be the final project, but this was the biggest project that we had to tackle, and that was the interior. And this is a picture from, I think it was a Gazette, it might have been in the Springfield paper, of when the Academy opened up. And, you know, most of these elements are still there. You have to really study in detail. There are a lot of little things that I discovered in this drawing that I had never known were there, but it wasn't much more than this. There was some verbal description of the basic colors of the theater and some broad brushstroke descriptions of the overall color scheme. And what they said in the paper, it just seemed like they used every color under the sun. And I'm sure there was a rhyme and reason to it all, but the reporter didn't really do a good job. So we had to decide, well, what color are we going to paint the interior of this building? Not only does it need a whole lot of work on the inside, we have to come up with a whole nother color scheme. So this was a theater, do you all remember, it was painted in the 70s when Dwayne Robinson was there. He did a great job preserving the theater, but it was painted in period colors in the 70s with this kind of a Hartford green and white wainscoting. Seats, these seats were from the 70s, these seats I think were from the 50s, and all the seats were pretty almost broken and really shot. So behind that facade you just looked at, you'd never know it unless you're there during the day, that all the walls look like this, like really major cracks. Every single wall was just totally flaking paint. It was really bad plaster ornaments that you'd never see in the dark because they weren't lit, but once you point a flashlight at them, you see that they're just falling apart. The building had a lot of roof leaks in the past, but they're all fixed now, so we just had to preserve the interior. So this was underneath the balcony. You can see where water came in and just rotted or flaked off all the paint. This was very heavily detailed, deep bas-relief wallpapering that had been done around this balcony box. It was just falling off. So part of, we had to look at what was there and what we had to repair. We also had to look at, well, what would have been appropriate for this theater at the time? What were the real colors, even though we couldn't quite figure it out in the Gazette? We got one little key piece of information that they said most of the walls were kind of a reddish color. They described all the silver and gold in different places. I think the ceiling must have been gold and blue and silver, and then the walls were mostly kind of a salmon color. But we looked at a lot of other theaters in books and in the region, and this is a Colonial Theater in Pittsfield where they spent about $20 million renovating it. And this theater was built about the same time, similar kind of design, because you can see these columns here that hold up the balcony. Later theaters, more modern theaters like, you know, the Calvin, they got rid of these posts and they figured out a way of supporting those balconies without having posts. So this is a very similar time period and style, even though it's a different architect, as the Academy. And we went there, this is from the book they did of the Colonials opening day. Really ornate theater, an extra balcony level that we don't have, but like I said, it has so many similarities. This is a little bit hard to see, but this was when we started. We went in and we scraped down a bunch of walls. This was in the middle of painting where they're really just going all out sanding the walls. But you can begin to see, and it's easier to see in, on a computer, but see this area right here is that same salmon color. So we found that most of the whole lower level of the theater was that salmon color. So it reinforced the idea that the Colonial was actually going to be a fairly good, inspiration. And this you can't see the color in either, it's really faded out. But this is a blow up of that one of the areas that we scraped down to the original paint. And see that it had these stencils all over the entire first floor were these hand-done stencils. So there was this pattern, and then there's this kind of floral pattern you can't quite make out, but it was like an enormous amount of stenciling in that building, very, very decorative. And this, you can see right in there, that's the darker salmon color. And then right in here, if this wasn't all faded out, you'd see that that was kind of a salmon color as well. So we went through a bunch of different places in the theater, and we scraped it down to the original paint. You know, it was paint remover and scraping, and we were really careful about it. And we kind of determined what most of the colors were in the whole theater. So not only do we have the...
Sorry, what year did you say it was originally built?
1894 or 5?
1891.
91, okay.
That's
okay. So, you know, we had the reference from a similar theater in a similar region, and then we had the paint colors that we had uncovered. So that allowed us to go forward with some confidence that our color scheme that we were going to propose had real historic legitimacy. We couldn't duplicate it because we didn't know what every single color was. Many areas had been removed, but we could go along the same path. And we had many good references to justify the colors that we were going to use. Again, more broken plaster, some of the pieces that just had to be taken off and replaced. Places that were entirely missing, that's bare wood there, that used to be a plaster molding there. Here's a plaster molding on the balcony box that's just been smashed in by years of speakers and equipment hitting it. There used to be a decorative pilaster kind of column right there, and it was gone, and somebody put in these two little gold posts.
Tom, is that paint coming off, or is that from you scraping it, or what?
Let me see if I can go back. Well, we'll hit some more, there it is. Okay.
Yeah.
So that is all missing plaster, like chunked out missing plaster. So if you imagine this fluted column that's just glued onto wood framing, and then someone bashes into it with a 200-pound speaker, you know, just over the course of like 30 or 40 years, that's what happens.
This so. Would have been wonderful. We had this at City Council when we were approving the CPA money, because this is unbelievable.
Well, I brought in some of it. Oh, yeah, I did it for the CPA, but I didn't say anything at the council meeting. The other thing we had to do is we had two boxes that are on the balcony that project out. It's called cantilevering, and they were always sagging. And the Academy wouldn't let anybody on there because they felt like they might collapse because they had sags so far. And it looked dangerous, and they're a little bouncy when you jumped up and down on them. So we pulled up the floor in those areas and put in some additional structure. We worked with a structural engineer and beat them up. And they're still sagging a little bit, but they're totally stiff and strong and never going to fall down. So we couldn't adjust the sagging because we would have wrecked a lot of plaster ornament in the process. Again, I did a full set of drawings for every piece of the interior of that building. Those are interior sections. You know, this doesn't show up very well, but this was one of our preliminary budgets, and you can see on the left-hand column is the budget we had, the funds from MCC, the CPA, first ever was a capital campaign, and then we had some grants below that, and we had a total of $505,000 that we kind of thought we had at the time. And then on the right is our expenses, paint, carpentry, seats, floor sanding, electrical, steel. And that was $513,000. So here we were $7,000 over budget, and we were scrambling to raise more money and to figure out how we could economize.
Now, with the electrical, we use our own electrical department here in the city, correct?
Yeah, Jim Malo did some stuff. He would have had to have been dedicated to that building for like the 2 months.
Oh.
So we couldn't pull him off. We pulled him off of the city work for 4 or 5 days, spread out over a period of time. He took down all the electrical, the lights and everything, and then he put them back up. But in the meantime, he was at the schools.
And how about like with the floor standings? Didn't the Central Service handle that?
No, we had to bid that out. I didn't know that Central Services had their own floor standing.
Yeah, they do it.
But we had a tight time schedule. We started in, what, August?
We had 9 weeks.
Oh yeah, 9 weeks.
We had 9 weeks to
So, so they had to sand the floor in like a couple of days. And then nobody wanted to stain it because the stain would take 2 days to dry. But I finally got my way.
But just keep it in mind because I know at Smith Vocational right now, the maintenance guys are up there and they are sanding all the floors.
Oh, that's nice.
And putting coatings on.
If you have the summer to do it instead of 3 days.
No.
And people were yelling at them too. It's better get done quickly. And then we put the painting out to bid. We made the painter the general contractor. Me as the architect, I could kind of project manage most of the stuff, the carpentry and the steel. But the paint we went out to bid on, you can see we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bidders. One was an electrician, he didn't count. The top bidder, Evergreen Architectural Arts, they are the cream of the crop in the theater world. And they're the guy that owns the company, his son goes to Deerfield. He was really interested in this project and he gave us a discount price. But you can see he was still $100,000 over Northeast Painting, who is a local painter. And I know in that Northeast Painting that there was a ton of donated work because he said I could easily have spent another $100,000 on this project. And so throughout the whole process, from me to the painter, to the carpenter, to the decorative painter, all of us put a lot of donated time into this. I worked for pennies on the dollar, but it was so worth it. I just, you know, everybody was really happy about it. So once we got our budget in line and we got all our color decisions made, the next step was to take out every single seat and then put up scaffolding. So you can see that's the stage there. This is the balcony. And then that is the floor you can stand on, which is like 5.5 feet below the ceiling. So we had to do all this is intensive scaffolding. I can't remember how many tens of thousands of dollars the scaffolding cost. It was like 17,000 or no, it was 30,000. That's what it was.
30,000.
And that was we did that too. So a lot of scaffolding, but it allows you to paint the ceiling and the walls and everything much faster than you could otherwise. This is kind of midway through the process. You can see the walls are now white. They scraped off all the paint, or a whole lot of it, and then we had to re-plaster all the walls. So what they did was they put this layer of thin joint compound on it, then they pressed this layer of fiberglass, it's called New Wall, and then they put another layer of joint compound, and they trowel it all off. And it really solidifies the entire wall surface, even though it was made up of tons of cracks. We tore out lots of big chunks that were just totally gone.
What's the lifespan on that?
It should last another like 30, 40 years, because it's got this mesh in it that you put on the wall that is like a fiberglass mesh, and it just like pulls everything, interlocks everything. Because the way plaster fails is it's all on a wood lath from behind, and that's what holds the plaster all together. And as soon as it begins to separate from that lath, then it starts to flake off and pop off. So we screwed it all down to the lath as well as we could, cut out what we had to that was just totally falling apart. And then we put this layer of mesh on the top and plastered over it. So it should have a very long lifespan. But the alternate was which is what we did at the Calvin, where you take every bit of plaster off the wall and redo it, that would be the fortune.
The house that I owned was built in 1880, and when we broke walls down, it was all horsehair plaster.
Yeah, that's what this was.
So that's what I was going to ask.
Yeah.
I mean, and that's like incredibly like messy and dirty and smelly. And so
yeah.
You guys did all that in this 9-week span.
Yeah, the prep was really big on this. Yes.
Why did you only have 9 weeks?
Because we had programming in advance on both sides, and we were opening up with our new show, our new production. Set amount of time.
Yes.
We were a business in operation.
We also had to get all new seats. This is the seating plan. One of the things, it doesn't really show here because that's the balcony. We had to incorporate new handicapped seating positions, and the Academy always had kind of unofficial seating positions for wheelchairs, but they're on a slope. So the law says you have to create a flat platform that you can roll into from behind. You can't be on a slope. You can't see people in wheelchairs on the slope. So we had to pick some areas in the lower level, the orchestra level, where we build flat platforms and made them completely code compliant. So we had to do that and buy new seats. This is just one of the many pages of different selections you can pick for the seats. We picked a seat that was, that's not the, that is the seat we picked, but it's like ours is a little, are much different looking than that. But we did, we picked a more modern seat, but the selections we made, the backs are wood looking, the armrests are wood looking, the upholstery is matches the colors of the theater. So we took a fairly modern seat and by picking the right accessories made it look like it fit in historically. Real historic theater seats have cast iron sides and they're like five times the amount of what we spent. So
what did you do with the other chairs that you removed?
They were donated to the Hampton County Sheriff Department, and the seats that were upstairs from 1947 matched the seats that the Victory Theater in Holyoke now has. So they are going to be restored and used at the Victory Theater. The seats downstairs, the Hampton County Sheriff's Department will refurbish and then sell them to a school or another.
Because they have to be totally stripped down, because to get a, put a new seat in a new public space, it has to be fire-rated foam and fabric. And you have to have paperwork to document that. They can't just take a seat from here and put it over there without the proper documentation.
And how long did those chairs last?
The ones that we, the new ones that we
no,
had?
No, the old ones.
The old, well, the seats upstairs from 1947 were, you know,
that's
not
a long time.
Not in bad condition.
They were well made. They had springs in
yes.
them and metal backs and stuff.
They
and
were
places.
Actually in better shape than the ones that were downstairs. They were used from 1960s, I think.
Oh, yeah. The plastic movie seats.
The balcony had been closed at different periods?
It very well could be, because, yes, the orchestra section does get more use.
We found that modern seats are much wider now than
yeah.
We had to put in the same seat widths, which are like 21 inches wide. They vary from 19 to 21 inches. The modern seats are 25 to 26, and they
wow.
have big cup holders. We couldn't do that, or we'd lose
some. That should make some people
happy.
Yeah, we lose a bunch of seats. Yeah, the academy seats, basically about 800. We had to replace the fire escapes on the outside of the building. In the middle of the winter, the one on the other side of the building had a partial collapse, and Louis Hasper had us tear it down. This is the one on the South Street side. That this is a good example of where that tread right there has pulled away from that piece of steel, and it's just, it's fall in the process of falling down. So, and you can see these funny old parts. It's all cast iron. That looks like a railroad tie almost. It's like a lot of different kinds of parts put together. So we had to replace that. Sorry, this is sideways. It didn't happen with this drawing. But that's this drawing for the stair. So this is on top of that scaffolding I told you about. So this is the floor right under the ceiling. And that's where they started. They did all the walls, they did all the plaster, and then the painting, they started from the ceiling and worked their way down. And so this is a painter up there doing this decorative painting. We had two painters. Painter crews. One was a decorative painting crew that was run by Jonathan Corman, who is a really talented local decorative painter. And then there was Northeast Painting, who's just the regular painters. So the decorative painters did all the stenciling, and then you'll see later they did a lot of work, glaze work on the ceilings. But a ton of time was spent up there. That's Jonathan Corman right there. That's Andrew Crystal right there, and I think that's Bill the painter. So that's under the main dome in the center of the auditorium. There used to be a white fan that stuck down from there. But let's see. And then this is my son under that dome. This is all, if you look at it in the right light, it's all very shiny gold. It's really amazing.
Is it built with that kind of subfloor, whatever you call it, so that that work can be done on a regular basis? Why is there that?
That's a scaffolding.
Yeah, that's the scaffolding that we erected temporarily.
But you said that there was a floor 5.5 feet from the.
Yeah, that was part of the scaffolding.
It's the top of the scaffolding. That's what was created by the scaffolding.
Yeah.
I managed the First Church's campaign when they redid their the ceiling and the walls, and so this is like bringing back a lot of a lot of time I spent on scaffolding, and they're similar buildings. They're built,
yeah.
You know, maybe 20 years apart, it seems, and.
And the same thing, once they started to excavate the walls, we found all this amazing stencil work that they ended up restoring.
Oh, right, I remember that.
It's an amazing process to go through, but I mean, in 9 weeks, I can't even imagine. It was months that we spent, so I can't believe what you guys did in that short period of time.
I won't go back. But yeah, that's the temporary floor we erected on top of the scaffolding. And there were these funny little vaults on the sides. You just never noticed a lot of this stuff, but they had these plastic stick-on paper on them. There's a lot of temporary stuff done in the 70s. It was one of the few places I specced the wrong color, and they painted it, and it didn't look very good, so I got up there on the weekend and painted it myself. Me and my wife. That's why I'm not done with it. This is what the proscenium used to look like. This is the opening to the stage, a big decorative frame around the stage, and it, I think a lot of this gold was original, but you can see this kind of fleshy color paint that was all done much later, and the whole theater was pretty much green, white, and flesh. And then we painted it these colors. They're much brighter when bright light's on them. We had to pick really bright colors so that in dim light they would actually read as a color. So they're, you can barely see some super bright green up there. It's the gold that we painted. And like I said, most everything was kind of white. This all underside was white, but a lot of the gold was original, I think. So this was looking from the other side of that picture I just showed you. You can see this is that big beam that runs around the theater. One of the things we did, we found out that this was all individual boards under the balcony, so we faux painted them to look like mahogany boards. This is the ceiling. You get to see it's the flesh color. And then this is the ceiling after we're done. So we picked out, we glazed all these panels to look like they were kind of had a lot of movement in them, almost like they were a sky moving as skylights above. And then we put a lot of detail in these big, massive beams. And then we painted the dome a more historic color. One of the coolest things is just these stencils they painted on these arching walls there. Just made such a huge difference. And in the beginning, you know, when we went before the CPA and they were short on funds, they said, well, how can we cut this project? And I said, well, I don't want to do this, but we could cut out the ceiling painting. And I knew it would be a huge mistake. Most people have never seen the ceiling in there because it just, there's nothing up there to look at, but you can do so many amazing things with the ceiling, and I think that this is a good example of how decorative you can get with the ceiling and just expand the grandness of the space. These were samples of stencils we did early on, just looking at different patterns. That's that box on the side that we totally repainted. This is a drawing showing all the different colors on it. And then this is the finished product, but still not quite finished because we're going to do stenciling in these areas here where that wallpaper used to be. So there's still work to be done there. We didn't replace any light fixtures. There's the same old sort of cruddy light fixtures from the 70s. We added a few new cheap hardware store light fixtures. But we got all the basic wiring done. And all the back, the wiring and everything behind the walls, we got done. So now we could just, in the future, when we get some more money, we can replace those light fixtures with something more appropriate. So that's the old theater. And then this is the new theater. The colors don't really read here. This looks kind of yellowish. When you go in there, it's much more of a salmon color. So that is, we got all new seats. So that's pretty much my presentation.
Do you have any questions?
Anybody have any questions?
I was wondering about who the original architects were. Did you say that?
They were...
Broxley was the...
same ones that did Forbes Library. They're from Hartford. Brocklesby. That's the firm's name. So they... I think they did, I can't remember whether Forbes or the Academy came first, I forget.
But they specialized in institutional buildings and that kind of thing.
I think a lot of architects at the time mostly did institutional buildings. I don't think there were a lot of architect design houses. There were a lot of plan books.
the fire escape, mm-hmm. I'm a little concerned here. We spent that money on CPA to do whatever we had to do with the inside.
Yeah.
Now, didn't anybody ever look at the outside of that fire escape before even looking in the inside? I mean, that didn't happen overnight.
Yeah, you have to have fire escapes inspected every 5 years. Nobody expected it to just have, I mean, it didn't fall down. Just
well,
a part of it
bad.
Separated, yeah. So, but luckily it did not just fall down. But, you know, it started to fail, and then we just decided we needed to take the whole thing down. There was a few local failures, which we repaired. We got a welder out there and repaired them, and then took one section off. And then that got us through the year until we could actually get the money together and replace them. But yeah, the code says you have to inspect them every 5 years. Remember the one that fell down behind the Mama Iguanas?
Yes.
Yeah. So after that, everybody got on the stick about inspecting fire escapes. So we have a brand new one there that should last another 100 years. It's made out of steel, not cast iron.
I guess I have one little question. You mentioned the Colonial Theater and how they spent several million dollars on it.
$20 million.
So was that like total, like they gutted the whole place
and they also knocked down their stage house and rebuilt it to be taller and more spacious and deeper. And then they had this annex, that car dealership that they incorporated as a lobby space. So they did have some additional pieces.
I was just wondering about the differential there.
Well, this was a shoestring.
Costs,
I mean, it really was a shoestring on a tight timeline.
Yeah.
So I am just amazed that we could get that much done for so little money. Like I said, there was a lot of donated time, too.
What a difference.
I
thank you very, very much for
sure.
being part of it. But it's just gorgeous.
Yeah. So we have more steps planned. You know, you go in there now and you can't see half the stuff that we painted because it just isn't the light to light it up. So we figured out how to light it. We just have to get the fixtures in place. And then there's some back areas, some back stairs that used to take you up to the balcony. So you could walk up these back stairs and then come in where the projection booth is now and come in at the very top of the balcony, and all that was really ornate plaster with all these arches and everything. And then when they put that projection booth in there, they just chopped it all up. Deborah wants to restore that. We don't need the projection booth because now everything's digital. And so the plan is. So we have a long list of hopeful projects in the future.
Thank you for all your work.
Sure.
It's probably a segue into your portion, Deborah, but I'm just wondering about the plans for fundraising and all of that.
Terry's up next. He's going to express our economic impact, and then I'll be up with the programs and then discuss fundraising, etc.
Terry, thank you for being here.
Oh, sure. Attached a couple of
And can you state your name and
yeah.
what you do?
I'm Terry Masterson, and I'm the city's economic development director. I'm here to talk for a few moments about the economic impacts of the academy. Last year, Deborah and I worked on a memo to try to define in specific terms what the economic benefits of the theater are. So what I did was I took that and, for the sake of the specificity, can walk through that for a minute. I've also attached a letter that appeared in the Gazette yesterday, which is about public art, but I threw it in here because the author of the letter listed a lot of specific examples of the benefits of the theater toward the quality of life of a community. And since my presentation is so geared toward dollars and pennies, I wanted to put something in it, but also acknowledge the intrinsic value of the Academy as a cultural and educational institution for the community, which is just as important as any of the other benefits. So I thought that was a good, very well written letter. And then I also attached an article from Syracuse Standard discussed last June of 2014. The city of Auburn had been working to plan to build a performing arts center in downtown Auburn, which would have been funded by the state of New York and Cayuga Community College. But the community in Auburn was so divided about the theater and about whether it was worth it or not. And several residents launched an environmental litigation war over the theater and went on for probably 2 or 3 years, and finally the project was canceled, which I think was a really tremendous loss to the community. And I put the article in because it's to make the point that we should really be thankful for what we have here, because so many communities really have theaters and benefit from them as economic drivers and others don't. It's a really important asset to be appreciative of. And that was an example of, you know, how some don't have it. And it's, for me, downtown revitalization starts with community theater in terms of its ability to attract people to come and enjoy the performances, but then spend money. And to that end, in the memorandum, there are enormous amount of benefits from the Academy. And I would also point out that if you look at some of the entertainment venues in downtown, the Academy is probably the leading venue in terms of the number of performances that it has, the attendance numbers that it draws, 116 performances, 45 to 50,000 people ticket sales, and the fact that it's being done on a weekly basis. I think that the number of performances is just as important as the overall attendance, because you're bringing in a crowd of people on a regular basis. It's not just once a month or every other Friday night or Sunday afternoon. It's week after week after week. And I think from an economic point of view, when you're looking at the restaurants and the shops and the eateries, that helps them provide them with a consistency where on a Saturday night you got 1,200 people show up, that's great, but then if for the next 2 or 3 weeks there isn't anything, that has an economic impact. And I think we saw Friday night, I think it was Friday night or Saturday night, there had to be 300 or 400 people on the grounds of the Hampshire County Courthouse for one of the summer concert series. I thought that was an awful lot of people. And interestingly enough, a lot of people of all different age groups, which I thought was very impressive. I was kind of looking at it like, is it a specific niche? It was pretty broad cross-section. The memo is very specific, and it should be. I'm not going to go through every dollar. I think the memo gives you a go. If someone says, what are the numbers and where did you get the numbers, the memo details that. We used an arts and culture measurement study that was done by Arlington, Virginia. And I took out some of their percentages of how many people would eat a meal before going to a performance and how many people would go get a drink before they headed home. And worked off some of those percentages. And with Deborah's help, we also tried to figure out ticket sales beyond a certain mile radius to try to calculate some kind of a hotel percentage, how many people would come here and stay overnight. And we put some of those numbers in here. That's another asset that the city now has with the Fairfield Inn opening up. You now definitely have 3 hotels in downtown, 4 hotels if you include the Clarion, and that's 400 hotel rooms. That's tens of thousands of people a year. To start to analyze as an economic benefit to the city as well. Where do they go? Where do they shop? How much of downtown are they aware of, and the academy gets to become a part of that visit. The New York Times has created a famous article, and it's become an ongoing series where the New York Times is always in its travel section focused on specific cities every Sunday, but now they have, they call it 36 hours, say 36 hours in Barcelona and 36 hours in Boston. So you ultimately want to get to 36 hours in Northampton, and the academy would be part of that package in terms of, you know, tourism attraction. I'll just run down some of the numbers, which are really incredibly impressive. Drawing over 50,000 patrons with 116 performances and events, $2.7 million in annual sales and purchases, which would include $665,000 in ticket revenue, $850,000 in meals and beverages purchases, $750,000 in hotel revenue, and $179,000 in city and state tax revenue. And that number, you know, if you extrapolate that number out over a 5-10 year period, is a significant amount of money. So it's a good number to bear in mind when you're trying to offset what public sector investments you're going to be making into the institution. This gives you a real specific idea of what the return is. So it's, you know, these are very healthy numbers. Any questions? I can.
I have a question about the total spending amounts for 2014 and the estimated for 2015 are essentially the same. Is that because it's your sense that we're kind of at capacity with this?
We were shut down for the 9 weeks, so we didn't have a full, you know, calendar of programming.
For 15 or?
For 2015, for 2015 and 16, are you talking about this upcoming season? Well, in last year, we found that PVPA was moving on and we're in transition. So I have kept everything very conservative, but lo and behold, like, I have some surprises when I get up there. So we're much busier than this report states at this point.
Okay. Yeah, I was just curious if you know, there's possibility for more, or if we're kind of, we've capped it somehow.
Yeah, we're certainly in a transition year this year.
There's also a balance between community events that, you know, they don't charge a big rental for.
Right.
Events.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So I have to agree with Councilor Klein because I checked it off on that. I have concerns too of not seeing an increase from 14 to 15 also. You're seeing this again, the same for hotel rooms and hotel guest spending. Everything is basically the same.
Well, the projections are flat because of
that. Yeah, the memo was written last year and we listed 15 just as
a projection.
As a projection, as an estimate.
Okay. Has it been updated?
So until the year comes to a complete, you're not going to be able to know what the numbers were. But it's worth noting that meals tax and hotel occupancy tax collections by the city over the past 3 years have all been the same year over year. And the hotel occupancy rates for Hampshire County over the past 3 or 4 years have also been 58% to 59% across those 3 or 4 years. What that means, I don't pretend to know, but it's just important to share that that's been flat, has been what is we've been experiencing for the past 3 or 4 years. That's not to say that more performances won't occur at the academy, which will generate more ticket sales and more attendance. That's definitely can happen, but in terms of downtown economic activity, meals tax is a good driver of what people are spending on food and beverages, and those numbers that interesting to see for 015 with the new hotel, Fairfield Inn, what impact that has on the city share of the hotel occupancy tax. That number should go up. So we'll see how that, because I've been kind of trying to track the occupancy of the Fairfield Inn, and it's been doing so far very, very well. And many times when hotels open and they're new, they do really well because everybody wants to go and be there and see there and stay there, and then it's best to measure them a year or two later. But for now, it's doing really, really great. And those are people I think are new, otherwise would have stayed in Hadley or Springfield, that come here.
Director of the Academy of Music going into my eighth year. And I want to say what a pleasure it is to come back here again almost every year. I think that I've been before, not this full committee, I think it was just before it was the cultural and arts committee that I would come in. And what I really enjoy about it, for myself, is that it affords me a time to reflect on this past year and where we've been and what we've accomplished over the year, and to be able to share it with the greater community. We talk about the Academy board and staff members, we're in it, and we talk about it on a regular basis. And there's bits and pieces that we share with community members. But today you're really getting a comprehensive look of what we've accomplished, through renovations, and as I sat there listening to Tom talk about the projects itself over the course of years, working with Douglas Architects and the other contractors that we've worked with specifically over this summer, and their devotion to the Academy of Music, and how much heart and commitment that they put into that project. It was just such an uplifting and inspiring experience for me. We had worked on this project for 3 years, and to have a crew come in and really sense the importance of that project for them, how they articulated it to us, and how they really wanted to be part of this community venture has meant a lot to me. And so I want to say thank you to Tom Douglas again and all the work, because I know that he has put a lot of work and a lot of heart into the Academy of Music. I mean, that pretty much says it all about the Academy for me as the executive director, is that the Academy is succeeding over these last 8 years. I have watched it grow year in and year out because of the community participation, because of what it means to this community. I get to sort of just be the face of the Academy, but I can't underscore the amount of love and commitment that this community has towards the Academy, so it makes me look good. We're here, we're back. I also want to thank Terry Masterson. He got up here and he shared with you that he is the Economic Development Director for Northampton, but he also sits on the Academy Board, so he's at our meetings, and he's been really helpful for us to understand what our impact is and where the growth potential is, and also crunching out some of these numbers. Since he's been on there, we've been working on collecting zip code information, and we have found out, we did this whole year, collected zip code information of people that are buying tickets, and from the sampling that we have, that's about 28,000 tickets, 18% are coming from outside this area. outside a 50-mile radius, so they are tourists. Those are people that are putting their heads in beds. They're mainly coming from New York and Connecticut, is what we're finding. But they're also coming from further reaches, like California and Colorado, to come see some of the pop culture rock concerts that are there that have not been out performing for a while, and they're just a certain amount of venues will fly out for a particular concert. So we're here back at the Academy Music Theater, and I don't think we have grown tired yet of that photograph. That was 9 weeks. There were other things that were going on in that 9 weeks, and I sort of shake my head when I hear that again and again. Yes, we did that in 9 weeks. There was this interior project that was going on. There was the exterior fire escapes that were also going on at the same time. And then on stage, behind that blue tarp that Tom pointed out, we were building a set for a new work based on the Academy of Music that was going to be staged on opening night. So there were all these timelines all happening within this nine-week period. Our programs include rentals. So we have people that come in, some on a regular basis, and rent the theater for a particular cost. We have 6-hour rentals and 12-hour rentals, and then you have runs. And then there's a formula for particular runs if you want to take out, you know, rent a whole full week.
How much is it? What's the cost for 6 hours and 12 hours?
For 6 hours, it's 720 plus stagehands, and for 12 hours, it's 1250 plus stagehands. And then when you go into runs, then it runs into 800, and then it's a formula for that week. If you want to screen a film, then it's $650 for 5 hours, plus projectionist. We present shows, and in presenting, we hire acts to come in, we guarantee them a certain amount of money, and then we collect the gate. We produce shows, so that is, we hire directors and designers and cast members, and we actually produce the shows, and we pay out for all those other expenses. If there are royalties on the show, then we do that as well. In that role, I'm the artistic director, so I hire the directors and things like that. We have been producing one adult show and a youth musical annually at this point. And this year, for our what we saw for our growth potential, is we've gone outside of the theater. And we started doing these story slams at Hinge. So we had a year and a half of story slams that were held at the Hinge. And then this past season, we had the Best of the Valley Voices story slam. So it was these contests and filled the house. So we do plan on, those were co-presented with New England Public Radio, and we plan on continuing those as again.
Deb, what about access for ADA, people in wheelchairs?
So that we can see on this photograph here.
Is it on the right hand side?
Tom, can you?
So there's a platform there.
Right there.
There.
Okay.
There and there. There.
Well, that's
thank
great, because I know there was
thank
problems
you.
Before the pillars, from
yeah.
way back in the
yeah.
right, you can't,
people
had
to
want to
go
behind
that. So some of our renters are, we consider resident companies and partners. We have resident company and partner criteria, so they meet a certain financial level as well, and also a commitment to how many times that they come into the Academy. Our resident companies include Pioneer Valley Ballet, Pioneer Valley Symphony Orchestra, Signature Sound. They are our newest resident company. They are good. This upcoming year, calendar year, I think they are presenting 10 shows. So they've really ratcheted up this year. A2, formerly Old Deerfield Productions, they're still with us. And they'll be co-producing an opera this year in January. Valley Light Opera, that's the photograph from Valley Light Opera. They moved in about 3 years ago, and they do one show in the fall. They do a 2-weekend run. This year will be Brigadoon. And this past year, they also collaborated with Amherst Ballet and brought in a zoo, and I can't recall the other show. We have Starlight Youth Productions, who performed this past weekend, Mary Poppins. And they do two runs a year with youth. WGBY Channel 57, they partner with us, and it's a trade agreement. So we offer them the theater at no cost, and they offer us media sponsorships. We have our season series program, which we're now in our fifth year. We've brought in main acts such as Selected Shorts, from Symphony Space, John Hodgman, Nobody's Girl, which was our new work last year, was also part of our season series. Women's work. I'm trying to think of Radio Star. So we do about five season series shows a year. Whoops, went back. There we go. So some of our programs, again, when we opened last year, we had staged our very first production that was based on a story about the Academy of Music that took place during 1940. We found a letterbox. I want to say about 4 years ago, we found a letterbox which describes the story of Mildred Walker, who was at that time the clerk, and the manager of the theater was called up to military duty. He went before the board and recommended that Mildred fill his shoes while he was off on military duty. At the time, the Academy was leased to a film distributor out in Boston, and they were in an uproar that a woman would be called to manage the theater. So they actually brought the Academy to suit. So we hired Harley Erdman to write the play, and we opened with this play last October. We co-present the Valley Voices Story Slams at the Hinge. We are looking for a new space this year with NEPR, and we are planning on continuing that series as well. And this year we're producing Uncle Vanya. It's by Chekhov, but it is the new adaptation by Annie Baker. Annie Baker is a playwright who's received a lot of notoriety in New York, but she is from Amherst.
When is that going to be?
That will be in March, the first weekend of March.
And did you say you needed a new venue? You weren't using Hinge anymore?
Correct. We're looking for a new venue.
Is there?
We've outgrown it. Not enough chairs.
I'm working on the new performance space for the Arts Trust.
Right.
But we're in the middle of trying to raise the funds.
Yeah. Right. We're in conversation with a couple of venues.
Yeah.
Downtown. Oops. Am I doing something?
I would steer clear of the lower left-hand corner.
Right there you go. Okay. We have our youth programs. Pioneer Valley Performing Arts School had been with us for the last 4 or 5 years, but they had rented 7 weeks. And this past year, they just broke ground and they're building their own building, their own performing arts center and stage. So they won't be at the Academy anymore on a regular basis, though they may come in with their main stage musical every so often. But this past year was their last year as a resident company with us. So they were with us for a good long time. We have they also work with the Starlight Youth Productions, but we have our own youth programs. We started offering summer musical theater workshops in the summer. We started off with 1 week for kids ages 7 to 11, and then we added a week session for older kids ages 10 to 14. And then we expanded that to 2 weeks for each session. And now we've expanded that to add another session for the 7 to 11-year-olds. And I'm going to say that they are so popular that we have a MailChimp list for our youth programs that we send out to parents that have already participated or expressed an interest. And I tell them, you need to sign up within 2 weeks or it's gone. So we have long waiting lists. They're very popular programs. And the woman that has been leading it, we just hired her on as our education director, Martha Petrala. She's been helping me to apply for professional development for teachers. So we're hoping in the future to offer a course where teachers come in during summer to observer classes and take what they learn with our workshops and bring them back to this classroom. So we're going to be teaching teachers how to teach musical theater in the workshop and get a state license for that. We also have in January, and I think this will be our fifth year, Academy Youth Productions. So we get a license for a junior show through Musical Theater International, and the kids put on a full production. Our summer programs are very process focused, so they get to dip their toes into the different elements of musical theater, and that's dance and acting and music and voice. But our productions are very production focused. So they come in, they get their scripts, they rehearse, they get their blocking, and we have set pieces, and we hire the union hands to come in, run lights and sound, so it's a full production. Last year they did Into the Woods, this year will be Music Man Junior. Here's a picture of our summer musical theater workshops. if you would like to see them in play, this coming Friday at 2:00 is our performance for the 7 and 11-year-olds. We choose a theme, last year I think it was heroes, and this year it's science. We have our traditional programs, so we have renters that come back year after year and are sort of identified with the Academy of Music, and that would be the Northampton International Film Festival, 4 Sundays in February, the Kids Fest, Django in June, and the Yo-Yo Fest. There are others such as Generation 4 that's been coming back in August, as well as First Night. the 4 Sundays in February and the Kids Fest, I do want to say that we co-present with the Northampton Arts Council. So they use the hall at no cost, and they keep the gate, and we get concessions. So this year we have some new friends. We are now collaborating with Cinema NoHo, which is a collaboration with the Parks and Rec Department, as well as the Northampton Arts Council and Forbes Library. That's part of the films that are being shown right now behind the Forbes Library. And when it starts to get a little chilly out there, they're going to be coming into the Academy of Music. We have some more dance schools in May and June. It's all dance concerts. You know what? There's so many dance schools out there. we keep bringing more in. This year we've added pineapple dance. We also have Alegria and Duke, as well as Pioneer Valley Ballet. They all hold their concerts in the springtime at the Academy. And lastly, right when Pioneer Valley Performing Arts Center had told me that they were building their own space, we met with Dance Malls Presents. John Sanders, who used to book at the Calvin, had decided to move to in with Dance Malls Presents, who's out of Ithaca, and they flew out and spoke with us and were very interested in booking now at the Academy. So Dance Malls Presents are anticipating booking about 10 shows a year, just like Signature Sounds. So both those organizations will be putting on music, roots music, as well as rock concerts. So we have a fair amount of that. So my job now is really to balance our programming, to make sure that we bring in dance and theater and literary arts, etc., because we're inundated with music events. There's a couple other things that I want to say about our programming, and that is that the renters that come in and they spend $720 for 6 hours and $1,250 for the 12 hours, and then there's the run packages. The Academy of Music matches that money. So whomever comes into the Academy, they're paying only 50% of the value of the space. When I first started at the Academy, the only programming that was in there at that time were rentals. So, for example, if they were bringing in $100,000, I was seeing that the Academy was raising $100,000 to meet its expenses. So that keyed me in to, we subsidize the rentals that are coming in, and but we wouldn't be able to, the market wouldn't be able to bear more than that. So part of what the Academy does in its community investment is to raise money so that these community organizations can afford to come in to and put on shows for the community. Some of the other things that we do is we offer a hall at no charge for some of these traditional community and educational events, such as First Night. As I said earlier, WGBY Channel 57, their documentary films, and public school concerts. So we love having JFK come in every year, and it's one of my favorite shows, as well as a Kids Best Fest, and now the Cinema NoHo. Cinema NoHo pay, as well as JFK, they do pay direct expenses, so for our staffing to be there. We offer scholarships for our youth programs, which is built into the program, and we so far we have provided access to over 50 students. We participate in downtown events such as ice art and chalk art and arts night out and the Great Gay Pride March. We participated in all those downtown programs. We work with academic institutions for educational outreach strategies, allowing them to reach beyond limits of their campuses, partnering with Smith College to present the Dance Theater of Harlem and Haitian musician Balo. We offered master classes when Taylor 2 came for the five colleges, and we opened the hall for educational tours. We also work with Smith students. We hire them on as interns. We offer history tours at no cost to the public. Tom participated last year, the year before, and did an architectural tour. Hopefully we can wrangle him to do that again. Mm-hmm. That was a very popular one. and we provide consulting services for our renters at no cost. We also offer the space for civic events, such as the swearing in of the new police chief. I think that's it. Are there any questions?
together in making the academy what it is. Thank you.
Well, thank you.
Oh, I can, before we go, I do want to, so that you were asked a question about growth potential, and Terry had mentioned when over a year ago when we put those numbers together for our economic impact, there were 116 shows. This upcoming year, with the addition of our new friends, which Signature Sounds and Dan Falls present, in October alone, we have 25 shows. So we really have an incredibly busy year coming up with something for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay, bye.
She's been with us for about a month, and she's extraordinary, so I'm really super excited. So I've been with CHD for 17 years, overseeing the homeless services that we have with the agency, and Grace House has been a program with CHD since 1984 or 5, something like that. It's been around for a really long time, and I think that Grace House or Jesse's House kind of spawned off of each other in the early 80s when homelessness started to really kind of come around a little bit. So Grace House is a program for women in recovery with their children. So we only serve moms and their kids. There are no dads there. It's a women's only program. And women are there from anywhere from 6 to 10 months until they graduate.
6 to 10 months?
Yep. They have to have custody of their kids or be in the process of getting custody back from the department. So we have an extraordinary staff, kind of limited, it's sketchy sometimes, but we have staff that are required by the state. So the program director, Jennifer, is required. We have a clinical director, Danielle Hartner. She's required. We have Kayla Rivera, who is now our family therapist.
Who's your clinical director?
Danielle Hartner. You might know her. She's been around for a while. Yeah. And we have Jessica Moynihan, who is the children's services manager, and she has an assistant that works with her. And then we have some phase workers that work directly with the women around their recovery and making sure that women go to meetings, that they have their, what is it called, their community meetings and stuff like that.
And
so
their
coffee dates. Thank you.
Building their sober community.
Yeah. So that's my part. So I'm just going to let Jennifer take it over because she's got a pretty good handle on things.
I'll tell you a little bit about the program. So the women are all referred to us from the Institute of Health and Recovery, and we have the house can hold up to 14 women and families. So depending on the size of the room, on how many got right now, we have 13 women and 34 people total, so 21 children. They range from, maybe 3 weeks, 3 or 4 weeks. I think she just had her month checkup, so I think she may be either 3 or 4 weeks old. And then our oldest is an 11-year-old right now. We do have a 13-year-old that comes and visits some weekends. So, and everybody has a bed, and they have, you know, their room with their belongings and everything. We should do share some bathrooms. But while they're there, like Jane said, they do have to be working on reunification with the children. So sometimes they come to us, DSS has custody, or a family member has custody, or they have custody. If they don't have custody, there has to be a plan for them to be reunifying within the next 30 days. Mm-hmm. And that's not necessarily permanent reunification as well, that towards they have full custody back, but just the kids are going to be coming to live with them within 30 days of them coming there. It's a really great opportunity for the children and the women, because there's plenty of staff on hand to assist them with rebuilding that relationship, as well as helping them cope with, you know, some of the struggles they're going through. There's children's programming, there's babysitters, there's PALS volunteer program that comes in. They provide all the toys for our playroom and check to make sure that they're up to standard. They come in and help provide some child care services so the women can attend needed meetings, which kind of takes a load off their minds sometimes when, you know, they're not trying to juggle, you know, trying to figure out who's going to watch the children so I can attend the meetings I need to go to. We have some volunteers that come and help with that. The women go to various NA or A meetings, or they have groups at the house. We have a recovery group, tobacco groups to try to encourage them to stop smoking. We have the family therapist, so they attend the therapy sessions for individual as well as with their children, again, to help rebuilding those, you know, damaged relationships. We have some of the other groups. We do seeking safety, life skills groups. I sat through one today where we were trying to work with them on learning better budgeting skills. We have a savings program, so women are required to give at least 30% of whatever income they have to a savings account to help them for when they leave the program, either with deposits for places or with a car or just whatever their need is when they leave. They have to save at least 30%. Some of the women save more, which is great, but we work with them on some of those skills. They come up with the menus, so they help us with grocery shopping and come up with the menus and help cook, and we do family-style dinners every night, which are really great for the women and the children to have that bonding time together, and they prepare the meals together as well. And there's, you know, the different chores at the house that they help with to also encourage those life skills for home maintenance when they do leave the program. And we've had, since I've been there, I started June 3rd. So I've been there just at a little over a month. But the day I started, we had a woman who graduated from the program, so I had her graduation party that day. It was really neat to kind of see that. And she actually still comes by often because she is a community resource for the women that are still there. She's developed good relationships with them and has been a good support. And it's meant a lot to them to see her having graduated from the program and being successful out in the community. So she still comes back, she helps us, she does some community service with us, helping with the grocery shopping and some other things around, and she's one of the community supports for some of the women for their coffee dates and the different things that they need, because while they're there, we help them build their sober community, and we encourage them to build it here, which is where they're at, but also where they're going to be living when they leave. So they do get to earn passes where they can go home for, you know, a weekend or an overnight. In a safe environment, they have to come up with safety plans to prevent relapse. We really look into making sure wherever they do go that there's, you know, a safety plan in place for things. But it helps them to be able to build their sober community out wherever they're going to be going to, as well as here, and that's real important for them. But she still comes around, so she's an encouragement, and it's nice for us too as staff to see the success and see the ongoing success in the residents we've helped. And we've got one girl who's graduating this Wednesday, and I'm so proud of her. I haven't gotten to know, you know, I've been with her through her whole walk, but since I've been there, I've seen such growth in her and maturity in her, and it's really, you know, refreshing to see this. And she's gone from someone who DSS had custody of her children when she first started and, you know, struggling with things, to now she's, you know, been sober for an extended period of time, built her community,
saved, where she's going to have an apartment when she leaves, and just last Friday got full custody back of her children, which she thought was going to be another 6 months or a year before she got that back. And she thought she was going to leave with DSS still having custody. But because of the, you know, such improvements she's made, they gave it to her last week. And that was just amazing to see that in her eyes, just that, you know, joy and a relief in that, hey, I really did this and I earned this. And people recognize that in me. It's been really neat. She's graduating on Wednesday, and it's really exciting to see that.
I am so happy you're here, because Peg and I have worked very closely with, you know, Jane.
Yeah.
On getting somebody to come from Grace House 2 years ago.
Yeah.
And it was no shows, and we would show up.
I think what you'll appreciate about Jennifer is, when we talked about this in our interview with her, is that she wants to be the face of Grace House. So she wants the community to know who she is, what we do for work. She's going to be going to Peg's Next Step meetings. And so, you know, really to be able to be engaged. We haven't had that kind of engagement since Kathy Bennett. I don't know if you remember,
yes,
Kathy. Yes. I just missed her by 10 minutes at Jesse's house today. But so I think that, and that's what we're looking for, you know, from the community perspective. They don't know who we are anymore.
There you go. That's why I said, right, I need to get them in here.
Yeah.
You know, we need to expose them. We need to let people know who they are. And I met Grace House with Dave Sullivan. We had a function out in front of the courthouse.
Yeah.
And it was about children. You were raising a flag.
Yes, yes.
Do you remember that?
Yes.
And Peg says, I'll call Jane, right?
Make
reservations. Nobody shows up. And
yeah.
Nobody's, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to be honest, a lot of people don't know who you are.
Yeah. And that's really, that's unfortunate. We've been through some significant change. You know, Kathy Bennett was the program director for Grace House for over 30 years. I mean, she was it.
Long
she was
time.
It. She was, yes. And it was her baby. It was everything. And she did all of the fundraising. She knew every single donor. She really kind of nurtured and embraced that. And when she left, it was really hard to kind of fill those shoes. Mm-hmm. And then we went through a significant contract change, staffing changes, and it just kind of, and so it's been really hard to find. I think that Jennifer's going to be the perfect fit. I think that she's a rock star for this program, and I think that what you're going to see, Marianne, is that you're going to see her face, you're going to be hearing about Grace House. She's already got some fundraising ideas, you know, for folks to be able to be engaged with, you know, that include the women. We're going to start to Danielle McColgan, who oversees the SRO.
Oh, there you go.
We're going to try to partner the women to do some of those community service work, because Danielle McColgan used to work at Grace House for years. She worked at Grace House, and now she's at the SRO. So she's going to try and work with the women to have them do their community service work.
ServiceNet also.
Right,
you know, when they have their program on what you're all about, you know, what you've done in your life, the progress that you've come from A, B, C, D.
Right.
It's amazing. They're all starting to work together, and I think it's great.
So I'm super psyched. I'm super psyched to be here today.
I was
like really looking forward to it. I was looking forward to bringing Jennifer, and we just have a really great crew and a nice program there.
I think we've
How many
built
staff?
The staffing up well. We've got myself and Danielle as a clinical director, and then the family therapist, two phase workers, which are kind of like case managers, really. And then we have the children's service coordinator, her assistant. We have two full-time direct care staff, and then a number of relief staff. And we have an administrative assistant who really helps with a lot.
So I'm hearing that you can, in your house, you can hold 14 women and 21 children.
We can hold, to 37.
Something
yeah,
like
we
can have up to 37 people. So we can have 14 mothers and 23 children, is that correct? 23
have
children.
Have you ever had that capacity?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I've
it's
had
busy.
To juggle. I've had to juggle. You know, I've made a bed chart, you know, and I've had a couple hours where I've had to sit there to figure out, you know, how we can squeeze in, you know, we've got one mom who's got two children, but she's going to start getting custody back at the third, and it's, well, this bed only holds this many, where can we put her so we can accommodate this family's needs, and, you know,
really
trying to work on
that. For CDBG grants.
No, Grace House has never done that before. No, but which doesn't mean we couldn't, but it the money's so tight, you know. But what I think is going to happen is that there'll be more fundraising to be able to do some of the real work that we, the shelter system, for example. I oversee a significant emergency assistance program that has all the money that we need for shelter space, for case management, for direct care, for rehousing, stabilization. You know, we've got a lot, and then you've got a program like this that's funded through DPH, and it's bare bones. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the bare bones.
So it's
funding.
A program of Center for Human Development, but each of Center for Human Development's programs does their own fundraising and has their own funding streams?
Some of them. So, for example, I used to fundraise for Jesse's House. It was just Jesse's House. We had eight families. It was over here where Grace House is now. And we would do fundraising and appeal letters, and we'd raise about $50,000 or $60,000 a year. When our contract was renewed in 2009, it was a significant increase in our capacity. We went from eight families to 84 families. So, and we were fully funded. We're fully funded for everything we needed to do. So we don't have to fundraise like we used to. And we don't have to apply for some of the, like United Way.
Yeah.
I don't apply for Jesse's House anymore because it's part of a bigger system that can afford to absorb some of those costs. But the Grace House, you know, it's a flat budget. It barely pays a living wage for some of the salaries. And so in order for us to be able to compensate salaries and do some really different programming and trips with the women and kids and camp stuff, we really need to fundraise for those things.
So you're not, are you writing grant proposals and that kind of thing beyond government funding?
Yeah, we will be. So
private foundations and things like that as well.
So what's happening is Jennifer's new, and then I've been overseeing this program off and on throughout those last 17 years. And Julie Schwager, who is the Vice President of Adult Mental Health, this program is going to fall under her. So right now it's under John Roberson, it's going to be falling under Julie. And so Julie and Jennifer will be working on, you know, grants and fundraising and all the different ideas. And, you know, Shelter Sunday, we've participated in the Shelter Sunday program.
They came and did some video interviews with a couple of our girls.
Oh, nice. Good. Yeah. So we're getting there, Marianne.
I'm so happy to hear that. Like with Housing Partnership, do you work with them also?
We haven't for Grace House. We have with the shelter system before, but we haven't with Grace House. So I think through the next step meetings, Peg and Jennifer will talk about how to connect the agency with the Housing Partnership, because that would be a really nice match. Yeah. We just got a grant with the Housing Partnership to do tenancy preservation for families in Northampton, households in Northampton, families and individuals. And that's just getting off the ground now. So, you know, they're her office is at the SRO at the First Churches as well.
I'm curious about some really basic parts that I'm not quite tracking in terms of how do women get to, are they court mandated? Have they been criminally involved?
Some are. I mean, like I said, all of our referrals are come through IHR, the Institute for Health and Recovery. So they send us the referrals for the women. Some of them are refer to the service based on DSS, may say, hey, this is something we want you to go through in order to regain the custody of your kids. It may be that the courts have said, you know, you're having these drug charges, you need to go into a treatment center. So sometimes it's that, sometimes it's just their family, or sometimes it's them on their own that want to come. And I'll be honest, the ones that come on their own, it's such a reward when they do succeed, but you don't see it as much as you do in the ones that are court ordered or DSS ordered, because they have more of a reason to be there and more of a reason to have to go through with it, you know. But you do see it. You know, there are other ones that come on their own voluntarily and stay voluntary. It is a volunteer program. You know, regardless if they're court ordered or DSS ordered, they're not forced to stay there. So they could say, hey, I don't want to do this. I'm done. And we always try to work with them on, you know, what are your reasons for wanting to leave? What can we work with on you? And what's your plan and your safety plan for if you leave tomorrow?
Are you equipped to work with women that might have kind of dual diagnosis kinds of situations and things things like that.
We do have a psychiatrist who's, contract with them, I believe, and they come in and do some of the, you know, evaluations and prescribe them the help medication that they may need. And then there's, you know, like I said, we have the therapy that can also help, because nothing's going to be cured by medication alone, and nothing's going to be cured by therapy alone. It's really a partnership with that. So we do provide both of those services in-house. And that's really nice. So the women don't really need to go anywhere to do that. We can all kind of do it right there at home properly.
And how do you deal with situations of relapse? And, you know, what kind of parameters do people have to kind of maybe go off the tracks a little and come back? Is there any room for that?
There's always going to be room, because people, if they really want it, are going to find a way to get it. But we do have a lot of preventative actions at the house. So, you know, the women have the phases that they go through or things. So they don't have any cell phones. We do random testing, especially if they go off campus for like an overnight pass or weekend pass, they come back. We check all of their belongings when they come in, or if they go shopping, we check all their receipts. We go through everything to make sure they're not sneaking anything. You know, we try to run a very honest program, an open program. There are going to be times where there's going to be mishaps like that, and we take them case by case.
We are a harm reduction program, so we know that there's the potential is there, so we try really hard to work with the women.
Yeah. They go through the phases, they earn more privileges. So, you know, if they've just been with us for 30 days or under, they go with someone who's been through the program for a while when they go to the meetings or they walk to places. So we try to do some of that buddying with them, which kind of helps prevent some of that, and then building their community helps with it as well.
So another question I have is it kind of geographically based, so that it's mainly the referrals that you're getting are women that are from Northampton or a certain catchment area, or can it be anywhere?
It can really be anywhere. They do try to send the women that are closer, you know, if they can, but there's a wait list sometimes for places. So, you know, we've got women who are from a lot from the Boston area, and now that way, I've only been in the state for 2 months, so I'm still learning
new
all the locations. but they do, you know, they do try to keep them close. Now, there's benefits to that. You know, there's pros and cons to being in your environment.
Right.
So.
A lot of times, women will want to be outside of their, you know, area of meaningful ties, because that's where all of their connections are. So the farther away they go, the safer they feel in trying to get through their recovery.
Right.
And is it considered like a secure facility if there is a domestic violence kind of background situation?
Yes. Yeah, we reserve the right to refuse anybody who's visiting, or if we feel like there's a danger or anything. And, you know, we always monitor. So some children that may have a relationship with the father, but it's not good for the mom to have that relationship, then we would separate. And the child may call dad with a staff versus mom. So we let them know, hey, you know, we're going to put the phone over, but you cannot talk to Susie. You can only talk to little Susie, you know. So we do put those parameters. You know, we try to partner with Safe Passages for things. Sometimes some of their meetings coincide with some of the other meetings that the women aren't always to attend, but that is a service that we, you know, refer people to as needed for things that they offer, a wide variety of different support groups and things. So, but we do, you know, we don't disclose the locations to anybody that doesn't need to know it. That's another reason why we limit, like, the cell phones and the internet access, especially when they're new to the program, is to help prevent some of that.
Do you periodically, Jane, go in to see the mayor?
I used to when Claire was here, but I've met Mayor Nakowitz through some other, you know, reasons, but we haven't been in to talk about Grace House and kind of the program, but that is something we should put him on our list of things to do.
I'm just curious what your background is, Jennifer. What brings you to this kind of work?
I have worked mental health for the last 12 years. So it's a little different than recovery, but like you said, a lot of our women do have dual diagnoses with it. But I've always worked with families. You know, I was a foster parent myself. I worked therapeutic foster care, which is a program that's for mental health, for children with mental health needs or behavioral needs, not strictly abuse or neglect. So I worked that for a long time. And then I also, so I have my bachelor's of psych and my master's of business. So working as the program manager really balances it, because not only am I, you know, doing the program, which can be really similar to a lot of mental health programs when you do the recovery programs, you know, because I come from a behavioral treatment background. I also have the business background too, to manage the staffing and the financial needs as well. So it was a really good balance. I really love working with the families. So
Grace House is a licensed program, so we have license requirements with it. Mm-hmm. Like the shelter system is not licensed. And so for me, having overseen this program over the last several years with the changes in the license requirements and stuff, Jennifer is a godsend. Because you really have to have the right person, the right balance to be able to work with the women and the challenges. I mean, they're coming in with a lot of baggage when they come through the door. They're newly in recovery, sometimes for 24 hours or less. And so to have somebody who's just kind of solid and has a good relationship with the women and can understand the licensing requirements, the documentation, the staffing, is really, it's hard to find that kind of match. So I think that Northampton and Grace House are pretty lucky. And our building is owned by the Northampton Housing Authority. So, you know, so Jennifer's been working on all of our, you know, fire inspections and that kind of stuff right. with the Housing Authority. And we haven't met the new director yet, but we're looking forward to meeting her pretty soon. So
I heard she's pretty good.
Yeah. I heard that too.
Yeah.
I'm eager to meet her.
Yeah. Well, it's just nice that we're in a room full of women. And we're running this program, and we have a woman at the Northampton Housing Authority now. So it's
hopefully now
it's exciting.
We've got you in, and we can get you to come back.
Oh, definitely.
Anytime. And the fundraising, what type of fundraising, and when are you going to start them?
Well, right now I'm trying to get so familiarize myself with the program, get all of our staffing needs fully met. We've got, you know, the contract reviews and things coming up. So I've got some good planning as far as, you know, the appeal letters. I've had a lot of people that have called us asking about in-kind donations, which I think are great because that really helps our budget, because we only get a certain amount of money each week to help buy housing needs and things for the house or things, you know, for staff morale. So I love, you know, doing some of the in-kind fundraising. We have Shelter Sunday, which is a fundraiser as well. I'd like to have a yard sale because our women have so much stuff that they don't need, and so do our staff, I'm sure. So that's something that we're looking into too, which helps bring the community as well as, you know, what I would like to do is take those funds and buy stuff for the house that we need, like another patio table, and then have like a big party for the staff and the residents, or, you know, something like that to help, you know, encourage the emotional, you know, morale and well-being as well.
Do you have a backyard?
We have a great backyard.
We do have a wonderful backyard. We had a garden that somebody came and volunteered and put a garden in. We need to get that redone. It had gotten a little overgrown, so we just cleared it out.
I don't even know where it's located.
Right. Oh, well, you need to come for a visit.
Yeah,
I've
been there.
It's right down, it's right down West Street.
You know that you're being recorded, so
yeah.
I don't know if it's okay.
I know. It's right on the cusp of the Smith College track.
Right by the horse farms.
And the base of Hospital Hill.
The brick house?
Yes, that's us. Yes, the kids go and the families go sledding on the Hospital Hill in the winter. Oh my God.
We have a big little play area for the kids.
Yeah.
An indoor play space and big outdoor play space for them too, and then they like to walk over and see the horses and over there sometimes. They go walk the track for a while.
I like to go over and see the horses.
I know.
Plus you've got all the neighbors in the back.
Yes,
yeah.
It's fabulous. We've got a couple of graduates there.
Right, and a couple of our children have made friends with a couple of the kids over there because they go to school together, so they'll go have some play dates sometimes. It's been wonderful.
That's super.
Yeah, it's great.
How do we get in contact with you if we want to do
just
a site visit?
Give me a call.
Or email her.
Yeah, or email jlewis, LEWIS, at chd.org.
Just made me think, so school, so the kids, when they're here, they get enrolled in school?
They
here.
Do.
Mm-hmm. It's a big transition for them.
It is. We, you know, like I said, that's why we have the child coordinator there, is to help with some of those transitions, help make it smooth, help do, they do parenting classes with the girls. There's a parenting group. We also, every day, we have child focused. Sometimes it's led by staff, but generally we try to have the parent lead it themselves, and it's just an hour block where they do nothing but focus on that child and spend time with their kids. You know, we try, you know, we've got some moms that have three or two, so we try to encourage them to set some time to spend one-on-one with each child as well, to just further encourage, you know, just that bonding. It's good for the kids because they're around some other people that are going through some of the same things they're going through, and to them there's a lot of playmates, you know. So, you know, while it's different, it's probably not the ideal living situation that we would think for children, they really do great and they thrive, and there's plenty of people around to help supervise, to make sure the moms that did have some of these parenting struggles, which is why DSS came involved, not just because of the, you know, drug issues and substance abuse issues, but also because of the parenting needs. You know, there's staff there to help encourage some of the, you know, teach those parenting skills.
And well, Jennifer had mentioned earlier about the PALs that come in. So mm-hmm. Horizons for Homeless Children is a statewide agency, and they go into shelters across the state, and they want to put, their goal is to put a play space into every single shelter. Mm-hmm. And so they've been to Grace yeah. House. They've got what used to be our old office space. It's a good sized room, and they set it up from soup to nuts. Every single thing you could imagine a kid wanting to have. Everything's brand new. And then they train their volunteers. It's an extensive training. And then the volunteers, you know, pick their slots and where they want to do their volunteer work. And so we've got a core group of folks that come over to Grace House and work with the kids and hang out with the, in the, you know, in the play area with the kids. It's really, it's quite something. And they have, you know, the mayors come, and, you know, all the politicians come for their openings and stuff like that. It's really quite something.
It's kind of set up like a little daycare center, you know, with all the little, here's a block center, here's the Voke Center, and that's kind of how the play space is set up. Because there are the children that don't go to daycare, or don't go to, you know, preschool. So when they're old enough, we do encourage the preschool, and then we, you know, of course they go to, you know, kindergarten, first grade, whatever age. But we try to provide a lot of some of that at Hatton House. Reach comes for early intervention, so they come and do an evaluation on all the children, and as well as work one-on-one as needed. We just got a hold of someone who's wanting to do some help out with some OT as needed, so that's going to be something, as well as speech therapy for kids that might need it. So there's a lot of good services that are offered for.
Super. Great.
Thank you.
I'm waiting to hear from Jennifer when you hook up with her.
Yeah, I know. I'm going to be out of town until next Wednesday, but get out with me when I get back, and, or email me before we'll plan. And yeah. Come anytime you want. See how I can get to.
Thank you.
Thanks for
giving me a second chance to get over here with somebody.
We never leave anybody behind.
Thank you very much.
Put your email on. Never knew Grace House was there.
Yes.
I go
How
by
often
it
do you drive
day.
Here? There you go.
Every day I go by it,
yeah.
And I say, and I was down that development because of the speed limit on Route 66,
oh, yeah.
And I was at the apartments and stuff in the back.
Yeah.
Never knew that was it. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for having us.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Don't forget, try to make that appointment to go in and see the mayor.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, we'll do that.
Yeah, we'll do it. I'll do it tomorrow.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay, I'm going to talk about the agenda for the month of September. We have Jeff Harness from the state coming in, and that's the one that you probably heard that there was a session. I think you were signed up and you didn't make that. You had to work. We had them also come to the Disability Commission. He right now is setting up his agenda, so he'll be coming in September. And then we also have, and Alyssa, I think you might know her, she's awesome, Betsy Shally Jensen. Do you know her? She's unbelievable. She's going to be talking about A Positive Place, which is a grant-funded program affiliated with the Collegiate and Hospital. It provides like comprehensive medical and social case management, housing support, advocacy, financial support. They do a lot. She does a lot. She's also the director of CLUDIC's recently convened Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Council. And I heard she's doing really great with that. So they're both going to be here.
Great.
Okay.
And then, as I mentioned before the meeting started, we do have. Phil Kleinman is interested in coming in. I think
think I'm going to suggest to him the earlier slot, so if you do talk to the folks at
Sure. So at what time is that later slot?
How do you spell his last name?
K-O-R-M-A-N. I'm from CISA.
From CISA.
That would, I would tell him about 4:05, 4:10, something
yeah.
like that.
For, you're going to give him the later slot?
The earlier slot.
Okay, so I should tell town farm
5:00 slot.
Yeah. We'll probably have a lot to talk about.
Yeah.
Agriculture. That should be enough. And I think we should bring in Spring Street Gardens to the farm down there. They're really working hard.
Yeah. The new director of Grow Food Northampton.
Yes. I wonder if he'd like to come for about 15 minutes or so.
Yes, we could do.
Could you try to call him?
How about if I can't do town farm, I can call him.
Yeah.
The town farm doesn't work out for October, I could contact Clem. Clem Clay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sounds like a play. And it might also.
And also, you could check, I mean, it could be one or the other, or it could be an addition. Whatever, use your judgment on that one. Because I don't think. That an hour or close to an hour is a long time for Phil to speak.
Yeah.
But, 40 minutes tops probably would be fine, I would imagine.
Yes, so maybe we could.
I can ask him about that and let you know if you want to.
Put the other guy in for 15 or 20 minutes.
Yeah, and then we'll have our agriculture day.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You're okay doing that one too?
Clem and Berkshire. Did both sets of minutes?
We didn't do minutes.
Have we approved minutes yet?
Yes, we already did that.
We did both?
Yep.
There were two sets?
Yep.
Did we approve minutes? Did it go right over my head? Pam, did we do that?
Yes, we did.
You seconded it. So
yes,
yes,
I did.
Oh, sorry.
I've got it written down. She seconded it. I said all in favor of the ladies.
But we have two sets.
Yeah, Councilor LaBarge announced that you were approving them as a group.
Okay. Yeah. The group part.
Yeah.
You missed the minutes part.
So move to adjourn.
Second.
Favor.
Aye.
And remember, we do not have a meeting for the month of August.